This is Lisa DeLay, and you are listening to the Spark My Muse podcast. Welcome, everyone, to Spark My Muse. I have a very special guest today, Gabrielle Earnshaw, and she is a writer, editor, speaker, and independent scholar on the life and work of Henri Nouwen. She is also the founding archivist for Henri J.M. Nouwen Archives, a position she's held for 16 years and currently serves as the chief archivist for the Henri Nouwen Legacy Trust. She's written the book called Henri Nouwen and the Return of the Prodigal Son. Thank you, Gabrielle, for sharing some of your time with me.
Oh, thank you for inviting me.
Maybe before we dig in, we can talk a little bit about your work as an archivist and what that has entailed.
Sure. Okay. So I was trained as an archivist, and that was how I started my career. I guess I still am an archivist, but although I have shifted more into this one topic, Henri Nouwen. So what happened is, and when Henri Nouwen died, he left his literary papers to his good friend, Sister Sue Mosteller. And she actually only found out that she was his literary executrix after the will was read. But he picked Sue well. He knew that she would take good care of his papers, and she did. What she wanted was to bring, to have all of the papers quite close to his home at L'Arche Daybreak. You and your listeners might know that Henri Nouwen, for the last 10 years of his life, although he lived most of his life, he was born in Holland and then lived most of his life in the United States, teaching as a professor, for the last 10 years, he was living in a place called Richmond Hill in a L'Arche community. And L'Arche is a community that was founded by Jean Vanier for people with mental disabilities. And Henri lived there, Richmond Hill is about 10 miles from Toronto. And she wanted his papers to be close by to him. What she did is she donated them to the University of St. Michael's College, which is part of the University of Toronto. And I was hired on a 6-month contract to process his papers. And in fact, those 6 months became 16 years. And yes, it actually took, I love to tell the story of how it took 10 years to just process his correspondence. His correspondence, which included 16,000 incoming letters that he preserved through all of his many, many moves. These letters from his readers and from his friends and from his colleagues and his family were very precious to him. And so when I was first hired, the thing that just sort of got my heart pumping was Sue brought me to the attic where all of his filing cabinets were, and they were filled to the brim with all of letters. And that was, you know, an archivist's sort of dream was to, you know, to be the person to be able to process these and, you know, discover the people that I might know who had written him. But also I always get more struck by the beautiful letters that come from his readers and, people who were living out, a lot of the wisdom that he was sharing in his books and in his lectures. And so that work was absolutely, it was transformative for me because I'd been an archivist for other organizations, other people, and had enjoyed the work a lot. I do enjoy archival work very much, but it was also the person of who Henri Nouwen was, and as well as the content. It was like he came into my life just at the moment that I was ready and needing the kind of words and wisdom that that he had shared in his lifetime. And then I also have to say that I was also transformed almost equally by meeting his friends. He had such special friendships, and his friends, like Sue Mosteller, like his brother Laurent Nouwen, these people became sort of part of my circle, and they, many of them are quite extraordinary people in their own right. And so for the 16 years, I was really immersed in Henri Nouwen's writing. I was reading, you know, drafts of his work as well as the final work. I was reading his correspondence. I was reading his teaching notes. I was reading his sermons. I was meeting his friends. I was traveling to Holland. You know, I am now realizing that my career as an archivist shifted to a vocation. And then after 16 years, I was asked to edit a book of letters. And so that really set me off on a new path. And that was to be editing some of his writing, which I've done now. I've edited 3 books by him, and this is my first book about him.
Well, it is so interesting in the book to read about Sister Sue and just how fantastic of a friend she was, and really, I think, gets maybe as an unsung hero in his life, although I'm sure people know of her who know him and who are more related to his story personally. But reading about her and how she encouraged him and lifted him up and helped him reconcile with people in his life, I was very touched and inspired by her commitment to Henri, and also her belief in his work and her desire to see him continue on with his work, even though he was having at times such debilitating problems.
If you've read some of Henri Nouwen and you know how important friendship was to him, he took friendship very, very seriously. I think it's part of the life of a celibate, actually, is to the importance of friendship is paramount, and it was to Henri as well. And he his friendship with Sue was this meeting of equals. I mean, he had a lot of friends, you know, that maybe he was more their teacher, he was more their mentor, but with Sue it was really this meeting of equals, and really this love that she had for him was so healing for him, as the letters show in this book that I just wrote. To find her letters and to see how devoted she was to his healing after a very, very, a severe depression, a debilitating depression. And she really walked with him through that out to the other side. And it's a beautiful friendship to read about, and to, I'm now friends with Sue, and just to hear more stories about how they influenced each other. It's very beautiful.
What's so interesting about your book is that it's a book about a book, but it's also about, of course, the man, and especially in the beginning, how the painting of Rembrandt's painting of the Prodigal Son is so transformative in his life, like a visio divina. And it would be good for people who aren't familiar with that term, or who don't know about the painting's prominence in Henri's life and the transformative quality it had in his sort of spiritual growth. Maybe you could just set the stage for that. Don't give everything away.
Well, what's interesting is I actually think that The Return of the Prodigal Son by Henri Nouwen is a masterwork in visio divina. I mean, what, and visio divina means entering into let's start with lexio divina. Lexio divina means entering into scripture or entering into text, and it means really from shifting our attention on the words from our head to analyzing them, you know, comparing them, sort of trying to draw, historical references from them, and moving instead to experience and to heart, to one's heart. So it's taking, Lectio Divina would be to take a familiar scriptural passage and read it several times, but in a way it's like rolling those words around in your soul and sort of seeing where, which one of the words, which one of the meaning of the word holds most resonance for you in at that moment. Henri would practice Lectio Divina every morning. In his morning prayer, he would use the lectionary reading of the day, and then he would sit with that text, and again, not looking for the historical references or the theological meaning, but more, how does this? He would ask the question, what does this mean for my life today? How does it connect with what I have been living or what I anticipate to be living? And so it's really entering into the text. So you would become each person mentioned. You would try to use your imagination to enter into the world. So if the scripture is about the desert, or is it about inside the temple, or it's to actually bring that to life within your imagination. And Visio Divina is using something visual so a painting of a parable is what Henri Nouwen used as a kind of way to enter into Jesus's teaching. What does the parable actually mean for my life? And Henri looked at this painting so thoroughly. He looked at this painting for 9 years. And each time he would, at first he was one of the observers. He was one of the people on the outskirts of the painting, and he was looking in at it in a kind of a longing way. He wanted to be the young man, being held by his father. Then he entered into what is it like to be the prodigal son? And he would, imagine himself with the torn clothes, with the shoes that are barely on the son's feet. What does that mean? How much did he walk in those shoes? And it's really using one's imagination to enter into the story so that you can take the meaning that you need from it. And Henri Nouwen also had this very beautiful practice of taking either words, if he had used Lectio Divina, or images, if he had used Visio Divina, and he would place them in the inner chamber of his heart. And he would do this intentionally and consciously. And so he even describes how certain images, like some of Vincent van Gogh's paintings, a special painting that his parents had by Marc Chagall, these, he says, sort of entered, were permanently in the permanent gallery of his inner interior space. And so he could call on them whenever he needed them. And it reminds me that, some people will memorize prayers or memorize a psalm, and they'll have it as the sort of like the staff that they need in difficult times. And that's what Henri Nouwen did with paintings and with icons and with visual images. And he also did it with words. He would take one word a day and kind of almost like clip it to a clipboard in an interior clipboard. And then that word would be the word that he would walk with for the day.
Mm. Yeah. It's so interesting how, for me, from a spiritual formation perspective, and that's kind of my jam, is that I love how he is allowing himself to be transformed by God through these different means that that are always around us, perhaps in paintings and in scripture, but he is really letting God work those deeply into his inner life to not just memorize them, but of course memorize them, but like really transform him at sort of like the cellular level. And what he does with the painting too, you mentioned, is that he becomes, in his mind, learns a lesson as he sees himself as each of the characters within the painting. And maybe you could talk about what are each of those characters and a little bit of what he learns, or maybe just pick one. And he allows himself to really be transformed by being each character.
Yeah, that's such a good word. I think that he calls it a spiritual adventure. Mm. That's how he sort of saw his life, was this adventure of the spirit. And I think that he was, the word transformation is really important and true. He saw this painting at a really low point in his life. He had many low points in his life. He was actually, and I think this is what maybe draws people to him, he was very anxious person. He was nervous, and he was needy. I mean, and I'm not ascribing these features to him. He is very honest about these. In a way, he had a kind of a wound, and I think, you know, this sort of idea that he was never good enough, and he was, were people really loving him, or did they just like what he said, and were they just clapping because they had to? You know, he just had this self rejection, and I would say that he was really searching for glimpses of God, but then also glimpses of God that loved him. And when he saw the painting, it was like, that's what happened. It was like this, he had an instantaneous, and he wasn't seeing the painting in the Hermitage where it's, you know, this massive, beautiful painting. He was actually seeing it for the first time as a poster, a worn out poster on the back of somebody's, office. It wasn't, but he was so worn down himself that just to see the young man kneeling in front of this, the way that Rembrandt paints the father is he's very, very old. He's, Henri even believes that he's blind. He is hunched over. But it is completely clear in the way that Rembrandt paints it, that he is loving and welcoming and blessing his son who has come home, the prodigal son. And so Henri really resonated with the younger son, and he wanted to be that younger son with these beautiful hands on his shoulders that Henri identifies as Rembrandt possibly painting as a woman's hand and a male hand. So this kind of the idea that God is masculine and feminine. He even says that, you know, the boy's head was the way Rembrandt paints him. It looks like he could be like a newborn child, sort of wet, head having just emerged from the womb. So this imagery of God as mother, as womb, is there. So, and that's where he wanted to be. But then he had to realize that the painting actually also had some tension in it, and which reflected his own tension, the tension in his own life. And that was this older son. And the older son is standing. His face has some light on it, same light that the father's face has in the painting, but he's outside the circle of light, and he's holding himself rigidly. His hands are in front of him like a shield. Whereas the father's hands are, you know, in this open embrace on the young boy's shoulders, the older son's hands are clasped. And as Henri identifies with this older son, he realizes there's parts of him that are sort of stuck, calcified in anger, resentment, competitiveness, sense of, injustice. You know, the older son, as we know from the parable, is just so angry at his younger brother for leaving and then now coming home, and he's been there all along taking care of his father, taking care of the family business, and he quite literally cannot get out of his own rage after all that he's done, his father is killing the fat calf for the younger son who took all the family money and squandered it. And so Henri really enters into the older son, and it's not an easy thing. And I think what Henri is wanting us to do is do the same thing. So when we're the younger son, you know, what aspects of our personality, of our life, of the stories we tell about ourselves, are like the younger son? And then how are we like the older son? And I think a lot of people who have, you know, heard this parable a lot will probably relate to one son or the other. What Henri does, which is, I think, you know, for me, I found it just astonishing. He, instead of staying as the younger son or the elder son, he, through Sue's help, like you identified at the beginning, he wonders if maybe he needs to also consider himself the father, the welcoming father. This is sort of where he really throws down the gauntlet there. I mean, it's a spiritual challenge that even he felt a little incapable of. And when I was writing this book and doing the research in the archives to find the letters from Sue saying, you know, I really encourage you to step into the role of the father, I think it's time in your life to become the father. But she had to keep repeating that to him because it's actually a very hard thing. The father in the parable and in the painting, he's the one unconditionally loving. He is accepting without a word. You know, the younger son probably had, when he was coming back home, he was thinking, okay, I'm going to say this, I'm going to apologize, and I'm going to like really grovel. The father wants none of it. In fact, the parable has the father running out of the house. I mean, literally running. This image of the extravagance of God's unconditional love is really what grabbed Henri Nouwen and what, you know, I think grabs readers of his book, because it's like a divine reconciliation. You know, it's this divine consolation. It's this idea that no matter what we've done, we can return and the God will come out and run towards us. Yeah, and Henri identifies that this receiving of God's love is often what people will not realize they're doing, that they're not actually, that they think that they're looking for God all the time. In fact, God is looking for them. And it's sort of shifting our way of thinking about our relationship with God. And so just to finish with the final evolution or transformation that Henri makes, he essentially says, I will become the father. I will accept this call. And he calls it a call that all of us have. It's to be the one who blesses. It's to be the one who welcomes. It's to be the hospitable host or hostess. And I think how this is so powerful right now in the days that we're living right now in the pandemic, because in a way, I think collectively we're being asked to enter into a spiritual adulthood, right? Into a maturity. That's what Henri Nouwen was challenging himself to do, to stop being the child, to first claim our sonship or our daughtership. But then I think some of us, especially of a certain age, can actually also then become the mother or the father, the generative, creative, loving force And our world is crying out for people to do that. And Henri would be the first to say it's not easy. It means that you do have to give up the, you know, the ways of the child. But I believe it really is what we're being called to. I know that I feel called in that way, that it's important that we, you know, rest and be the prodigal son who allows God's hands to be on our shoulder, and we feel that love. We really sink into that love, and we walk through our anger and resentment of the older son, and we then become the source of love that the world is so in need of. Generosity, kindness, warmth, patience, all of these beautiful qualities of love. And that's what we're called into right now. I think if anyone can answer that call, it's now's the time to do it.
That is such a good point. With being inside a lot more and having things curtailed, it's a kind of hermitage that we have been forced into, where you have to take, whether it's your spiritual formation or whatever it is, your growth or the weaknesses of your personality or your life into question. Think, you know, am I shopping because it's therapy? Have I been distracting myself because I don't want to feel discomfort? And all those things to realize that when they get called into question, we might have to rise to the occasion of better maturity. And one other thing I wanted to really underscore that you were driving at a moment ago was that this change, this big adventure of Henri deciding it's time to be the father. And, you know, he because he was so sort of heartsick to be received as the son. But what's so interesting to me, and for anybody who's like me, who's struggled with self-acceptance or having trouble with self-worth and feeling, I can relate to Henri in some of those ways where I feel like working to earn love or something like that, or I'm not enough, is that he realizes, I believe, that he has to be the father to himself and receive himself first before he can be the father to anyone else. And he has to give himself all that love, kind of be the son and the father at the same time. Would you say that?
That's right. Yeah. That's so important. It's this, again, it's this claiming. It's a claiming of our identity as children of God, as the beloved of God. And Henri Nouwen took at least 50 years to get there. So, you know, I mean, and then he, at the same time that his book, The Return of the Prodigal Son, came out, which took 9 years to write, another book came out that I sort of see as its sister book, and it's called The Life of the Beloved. And this is really where Henri explores this, the importance of claiming our identity as the children of God, as the son or daughter of God. And really, yes, it's a really important point to make. You can't become the mother or father without claiming your sonship or your daughtership. That's the first, it's receiving love. And I think that's where a lot of people relate to his book, is that this, it's one thing to give love. You know, I'm sure there's, in all of our lives, we know how wonderful it is to shower someone with love, but sometimes it's harder for us to receive the love. And I think that Henri really had to go through that crucible, and the painting, which I see as his icon. It's like, well, he called it his personal painting. I see it as well as his personal icon. It really gave him the visual imagery of how God welcomes us. At all times, we don't have to do anything. We don't have to, you know, we don't have, the prodigal son got on his knees and he's kneeling against his father's chest in the painting. But God isn't asking us to do that. God wants to just welcome us home. And that's, you know, to really claim that, that's the first That's the first and one of the hardest things to do is just keep claiming that over and over again. But then what Henri does is he goes further, and that's why this book is so challenging. He goes from, you know, sort of getting such relief and consolation from seeing God's unconditional love for him, but then he goes further and he says, and I need to be that unconditionally loving presence in the world.
It's amazing. Your book talks about how after he sees this poster of the painting, that he writes 11 books in 4 years. It was, that's pretty transformative. But and then he's also, it's not like a happy epiphany where things just go great. He's actually really, really struggling, and he has this obsessive relationship with Nathan Ball, who he seems to adore, and then Nathan is probably like, okay, too much, too much Harry right now. So then he feels so rejected, and he speaks about this, I think, very frankly in his book, The Inner Voice of Love, talking about sort of recovering from that neediness, or maybe not even recovering, but just moving through that neediness. We're not talking about this. I guess what I'm trying to say is after he sees the painting, he's not sort of like in an ecstatic, happy state where he just produces all this stuff and like, yeah, I feel close to God now. He's actually tossed in a storm for years.
Yeah. Right up to the end of his life. I mean, right up to the end of his life. So yes, I think that that's really important to say and to know that Henri Nouwen, even though he was able to come to these very profound insights, to live them is something quite different. I mean, it's like he came to the insights, he shared those insights, but then it's to live them was something different. But I have to say that he did live. He became, according to the people who knew him, he did become much more calmer, more, he did start literally blessing people. He was a Catholic priest, so he had opportunity for that in liturgy. He started being the person who stayed home. And welcoming people. But I want to that point, to your really important point, I think the book is also about, Henri Nouwen's book, The Return of the Prodigal Son, is also about leaving. It's called The Return of the Prodigal Son, A Story of Homecoming. But the book is also about leaving and how God encourages us to leave. So it's not that that we have to follow, sort of stay still once we've returned home. It's to be able to leave again, to go out and explore and to become who we are, our true selves, and then come back. You know, Henri used to say that life is just, you know, the 10, the 20, 30, 40 years, however long our life is, to say to God, I love you too. You know, and there's this encouragement in Henri's way of expressing the spiritual life that we are to leave and we're going to return. Another thing he talks about is that we're never going to stop being the prodigal son or the older son, or we will be oscillating, vacillating between the child that sort of is selfish and thinking of themselves, and then also contending with bitterness and resentment. And I think that that's the human condition. But Henri and God ultimately is asking us to keep returning. When you find yourself leaving, also keep returning. If you think about our moment right now, I see this really as the moment where we're wondering, do we need to change direction? Do we need to return? To return to home? Home could mean truth, or home could mean love. The younger son is referred to as squandering his riches, squandering his life, exploiting. You know, he was exploiting women. He was exploiting. I just feel like, in a way, our society can be seen like the younger son. And now, can we stop our squandering? Can we come to our senses, like the parable says, you know, that, that he comes to his senses and realizes he can go back home? Can we do the same thing? I guess I want to just, really underscore that Henri Nouwen was far from achieving all of that he was writing about, but he points a way. He points the way, and he, I think another important point is that he would say to us who are, if we do want to accept this challenge, that what's imperative to do are three things, and he would use this pattern. He does this pattern based on Jesus's own life of spending time with God in solitude, in stillness, in silence, as one of the most important activities of our day, is to spend time with God, is to commune with God, is to connect with God, listen to God. The way that Jesus did, Jesus would take time away on the mountaintop or in the desert, but he would spend time with his Father. And then we are to spend time with our community. Like Jesus would come down from the mountaintop and then spend time with his disciples. We can spend time with our friends and laugh and, enjoy life and all it has to offer, and sort of build up a bonds of fellowship and love and feel love and receive love. And then we go out and we do our ministry. And it doesn't necessarily mean, if you're ministry, meaning that, you know, you've got to be an ordained minister. But I think it means to go out and be of service, be of help, where it could be just being, you know, a very loving presence in your household. That might be it. Or it could be as much as going into prisons right now and helping there, or with refugees. I mean, but that's the model that Jesus gave us. And that's the model that Henri would say, in order to really take on this challenge of being a loving presence in the world, we need to connect with God. We need to connect with our friends, and we need to, from that place, go out into the world and say, where can I be kind, generous, accepting, all of those things.
I love how you talk about that we're not just one of the characters in the painting, that we're, you know, we will vacillate. And I think that's not just realistic, which it is, but that is normal life and spiritual development. Normal means that you're going to feel different things at different times. You're going to be at different places at different times. And that's really important point, because that's another thing that people can do if they're anything like Henri, is just beat yourself up when you're, oh, now I'm the sun again. Oh no. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just like, but you can be the sun too. And then you can move on to something else. And I think someone had said to me recently, this point about the prodigal son, when the story is read to people who experience poverty, who are not in affluent areas like Canada or the United States, and they tell the whole story, there is one thing that stands out to them more than anything else that doesn't stand out to us. And it's that there was a famine. And I think that that's a really interesting point that ties into where we are now. So we are in a kind of famine in the sense of pandemic, where typical things have been sort of turned off. And it's then when the son comes to his senses and he thinks, supplies have run out. There's no toilet paper. No, but supplies have run out. He has to go feed pigs. And he's like, what does this come to? I have to go back. And it's interesting that is the human, I think that's the human condition. That if we find ourselves in this place of famine, or this place of, you know, I didn't expect myself to be feeding the pigs and eating the pods here, there's spiritually or in any other way, that there is a way to come back into God's embrace, which has never changed, which has never been turned against us, and also to receive ourselves back again too. And I think that that's the beauty of how Henri opens up that painting. You know, it's, you think, oh, it's just a painting. It's like, apparently not. Apparently there's a lot going on here and a lot of layers. I'm taking a moment now for a little pledge drive for the Spark My Muse podcast. If you could take a moment of your time to go to paypal.me/Lisa Colon Delay and pay what you can, it would help greatly to support the show. You can be a monthly supporter at any amount you choose at patreon.com/sparkmymuse, and that unlocks weekly access passes to all the show notes and other news and goodies. It makes a big difference when you support the show, whether you write a review on iTunes or share this episode with a friend. Please help me support the show, grow it, and make it financially viable. Enjoy the rest of the program. His book is profound and deeply moving, but hearing all the backup and all the letters and all the correspondence of what brought that to be is definitely a treat and a treasure.
When you were speaking, I was thinking about how this painting hangs in the Hermitage in St. Petersburg, and Henri went to see the painting finally. Like he studied it he first saw it on the poster, and then he studied it in books and all of that kind of thing. And then finally he got the chance to go to Russia and to see the painting. And what I love is that I found an oral history interview, which the person who accompanied Henri to Russia, his name was Bob Massey. And he describes, you know, going into the Hermitage to see the painting. And for him, the painting was actually kind of gloomy. And he wasn't terribly interested in the subject. And he said, if Henri hadn't have been there with me, he probably would have walked right past it, which I'm sure we can all kind of have had that experience, you know, being in an art gallery and just not really connecting with any of the paintings, just sort of walking by these masterpieces that other people may have spent their entire lifetime, studying. But that, you know, for Henri, there was something about this, the way that Rembrandt painted. I mean, he had probably given sermons on the parable many times. He'd probably seen a lot of depictions of the parable of the return of the prodigal son, but it's the something about the way that Rembrandt painted it that really touched his soul. And it became this soul journey, and he was able to use it as a form of transformation, like we said at the beginning.
I was so interested too to read on page 145 that he actually found a new painting that brought new insights to him, the trapeze metaphor. And maybe you could just give us a little taste of some of what that was about.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. So, I mean, Henri was, the way he was wired was to be looking for God at all times. So that's where he was his attention was. That's where what he was attuned to. So before he saw the Return of the Prodigal Son painting, he had spent a lot of time with some Russian icons. I mean, he had spent a lot of time with some Vincent van Gogh paintings. He was very visually attuned. But then, and I just love the metaphor of this, is that he goes to a circus with his father, and they are sitting there in this, and you know, the circus is fun. He thinks it's great. His dad and him are kind of on really good terms at this point. They're both, I think, you know, Henri was now in his 60s and his dad was in his 80s, and they were enjoying this circus. But then the next thing that happens, Henri now was unprepared, this trapeze troupe comes through the tent, and he becomes transfixed. And so what I like to think about is, if I was sitting beside Henri, I probably would have thought, wow, this is a really good show. You know, these guys are really athletic, and wow, what a good show. But he did not see that. What he saw was God catching him. That's what he saw. He saw it through the eyes of faith. He saw it with his spiritual vision. He saw that this idea of, and I guess it comes back to this idea of leaving and returning, you know, the way that the trapeze, the flyer lets go of the bar, jumps, and then comes back, and the catcher catches the flyer. And so the catcher is God and the flyer is us. And then he, you know, that's his first sort of aha moment. And he's actually so excited by this that he goes the next night and the next night, and his dad is no longer coming with them. He eventually meets the troupe. He starts to study them. There are all of these notebooks in the archives of his drawings of the rigging of for the trapeze. And he really does become fascinated with this trapeze troupe. And suddenly a lot of themes about the spiritual life come for him, they come alive. So it's, you know, the trapeze troupe is like a community. They're like friends. They have to deal with failure. They have to deal with hope. They have to deal with brokenness. They have to deal with, disappointment. They have to deal with pain. So there's a lot of the spiritual, you know, aspects of the spiritual life. You can see how he would, well, once he pointed it out to us, how this trapeze troupe actually helps us see how to live our spiritual lives. And that's what he started getting quite excited about after the return of the prodigal son. After he saw the painting, he started getting excited about this trapeze troupe. And unfortunately for us, he died before he was able to actually fully understand why this particular troupe was so a lot enlivening for him. We have notebooks and we have a few articles that he wrote, but it's his great unfinished work was why this trapeze troupe struck him so profoundly as an image of our life in God.
It's really neat how he would so carefully study something to understand himself better and understand how God works in our inner world like that. He's so saturated with the spiritual, no matter what condition he's in, whether it's, you know, whether it's euphoric or in the depths of despair, he's still so saturated that he can't help but to see the spiritual in all those things.
The physicality of the trapeze troupe was really where he was, that was his sort of growing edge. You know, he was a person who had you know, sort of neglected his body, his physical self. It was very much about emotions and thinking. So very, very head, he was cerebral in a way, but he was also extremely emotional and very feeling centered. But his body, moving his body, being in his body was something that he wasn't comfortable with. And so part of the attraction to the trapeze, I think, was the physicality of it, the way that that human beings can use our bodies to experience life and to, you know, to all of our senses and the sort of the joy in being human, in being in a body. And I think that had that was something he hadn't explored very much up to that point. It seemed like he was ready. It was like, to use a circus metaphor, a trapeze metaphor, I think he was ready to step off that platform, you know, and start flying in that way. And in fact, there's a scrap of a manuscript on the trapeze where he says, you know, the top of the document says, what is the risk? And I think he was starting to think about how he wanted to talk more about what it's like to be in a body.
I read Adam God's Beloved in a theology of disability class that I was in, and I have a son who has autism, and that was a very touching and moving book to see how he was transformed by caring for and living alongside it was a core member. Adam was a core member, and then he died only a few months after Adam died. that was a physicality issue as well, where he is caring for, feeding, bathing, helping in very physical, bodily ways. And I think that was something, of course, he wouldn't have been used to whatsoever. You know, that doesn't come up in regular life. That, I think, maybe in coordination with the trapeze troupe, he was really edging over to understanding himself maybe in embodied ways, or ways that he had shut down or couldn't express as a celibate too, in those ways as well. His life seems cut short because it seems like he died too young, obviously. But do you know what was the last book that he wrote chronologically?
Adam was the book. Okay. Was the book, so you've just mentioned that. So that's the book about his friend Adam, the core member from L'Arche. And he had that book in his attaché case when he died. And so what happened with that is that the book was taken up by Sue Mosteller and the publisher Orbis Books. So and the editor there is Robert Ellsberg. So Sue and Robert completed that book for Henri. It was nearly finished. So they did the final, you know, the final touches on it. So that's the book that he was writing at the time, instead of the trapeze book, which is quite interesting. You know, he had the notes for his trapeze book, but he still wasn't 100% understanding, I guess, the links between Adam, his book on Adam, about the importance of caring for Adam, and how that linked to his fascination with the trapeze. I mean, he was slowly making those connections, but they weren't solid yet. So that, yeah, that is part of the I guess, the sadness that he didn't live longer to give us the complete version for that new way of a new way of thinking about the spiritual life that was more embodied.
And also, it was fascinating to know that when the book came out, it didn't make much of a splash. It's only been this kind of long, slow burn into becoming a classic and so transformative for so many people. Mm-hmm. But at the time, it was sort of forgotten when it first came out. And that just goes to show that if we have something that we want to write about and it doesn't seem to catch on right away, it doesn't mean that it hasn't been worth it to write about.
Yeah, it will find its readers. I think that's the lesson here. And I think it's still his most popular work, even though he wrote 39 books. And wow. Some of them are very, very good as well. You've referred to The Inner Voice of Love, which is a favorite of mine. But The Return of the Prodigal Son is this book that seems to, I feel like, I mean, Henri Nouwen had this open way of writing that I wish I knew how to do it, because he seems to, the way he writes doesn't exclude anyone. So, his writing can be read by anyone on the, you know, from a very conservative Catholic to a very progressive United Church person. You know, it's read by all the people in between. I think that's part of its appeal. But I think also just this portrait of this loving, extravagantly loving God that welcomes us home at all times, no matter what we've done. We've never done anything bad enough that God will not welcome us home. That message is so needed, and I think people just drink it up. And then I think there's a small industry in posters of The Return of the Prodigal Son, because I think people want to have it in their house to remind themselves that God is not a punishing God. God is not out to get me. God is not harsh. God is gentle, loving, motherly, fatherly, all the best of those words, feminine, masculine. And that's the power of his book, The Return of the Prodigal Son.
The book is called Henri Nouwen and The Return of the Prodigal Son, The Making of a Spiritual Classic by Gabrielle Earnshaw. Where can people find more about the book or about you and your work?
Okay, well, I have a website. It's pretty easy to find, GabrielleEarnshaw.com. And you can find information about the book there. The publisher is Paraclete Press. So you could go to the website for Paraclete Press, and they also have some information about the book. We're going to have a webinar about the book on May 12th when it is released. And I'm very, very excited because Ronald Rollheiser has agreed to come into conversation with me. He is, I think you know as well as your listeners, he's a beautiful voice for the spiritual life these days. And he mentions and speaks about Henri now in really important ways. And so to have him with me I'm very honored by that. And I think it should be a great conversation. We're going to be interviewed by Karen Pascal, who's the head of the Henri Nouwen Society. So it's going to be I anticipate it will be quite a rich conversation.
I appreciate your work, and let me know what you're doing next, because it would be fun to have you back on.
Oh, thanks, Lisa. That's great.